copy here sucks.
Well, in this building or in UK?
Yeah, in this building. Mm-hmm. Free copy, it's terrible.
It's free.
You know, it's actually a good brand. It's not a cheap coffee.
What is
really?
Yeah. I forgot. It was like Nescafe Premium, some
what's brand. That?
Yeah. The free coffee upstairs, yeah.
Oh, right. Well, I take tea so well.
There's some coffee shit, no matter what.
Yeah, the coffee at Pret's pretty good as well. And I actually, for a while, was getting coffee at Waitrose, but I don't do that anymore. Because it's like a coffee at Pret is $2.50, a coffee at Waitrose is $2.50, but at Waitrose, you have to sit there and drink it. They don't give it to you in like a to-go cup anymore.
Oh, really?
Yeah. They won't do that. You have to buy one of the like refillable, like non-disposable takeaway cups if you want it in that.
That makes no sense. Man.
So I was like, I even told them like the last time I went there to get a coffee, which was a while back. They were like, oh, yeah, we don't give it in takeaway cups anymore. You have to buy one of these. I'm like, so you want me to pay you guys £4 for a cup of coffee so I can buy a £2.50 cup of coffee? And I was like, you guys realize that you're right next door to Pret, who will just give me the coffee for £2.50, right?
And with the cups.
They'll actually give me a cup. And she was like, oh, well, you know, the environment. And I'm like, all right, bye.
It's marketing.
Yeah. What if you use... they actually can give you, what if you sit down and then it's like, okay, I have to go now.
Don't know. They don't care about your jet set life, Gaston.
For coffee, £4.
Yeah. No, that's for the cup.
The cup.
Oh, okay.
And I guess, so Damien was telling me, Damien's the Android SME, that if you have a Waitrose card, then if you show up with one of these cups, they'll actually just refill it for free. So you can actually get free coffee or free coffee with a Waitrose card if you buy the cup.
Hmm. Yeah.
So it's like £4 for a cup, and then they just refill it forever. But I'm not gonna play their games.
Imagine to carry all this cup again.
Anytime. Well, plus I have to keep like washing it out. It's like Damien had his cup for like 3 weeks and threw it away because he was like, "Oh, it's disgusting now because I'm not cleaning it." I'm like, that's time for that, right? Like, so, yeah.
I just get a cup of tea.
You know, I wish that I liked tea more, but like I don't love it. Like maybe I haven't been in England long enough to love tea.
yeah, it's like the culture.
Yeah.
Cup of tea.
Yeah, and in America we drink iced tea.
Yeah, in Greece as well. Yeah. Amazing.
Which is good. I do like iced tea. Iced tea with lemon.
Lipton, what do you do?
What's that?
The Lipton
iced tea.
Oh, that one is.
And now the new Guarana and all this stuff.
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah.
Here you look like a weirdo if you take iced teas, man.
That's what some guy said to me at a restaurant, actually. He's just like, you lot are weird.
I've been judged many times for having iced teas, man.
Iced tea.
You don't know until you try it, buddy. It's delicious.
Yeah.
All right. So now... Before, when I was pulling out columns, and I was using iLock, right? This wouldn't have worked. I had to actually do like the thing to pull out the columns outside of the iLock method, right?
Mm-hmm.
However, in here, I actually can pull out both rows and columns. I just have to use an index number for everything that I'm doing, right? Yeah, which this is a little bit like, I guess it's nice that it has this, but to be honest, like, we're not really ever going to pull columns out this way, probably.
Right.
Yeah. Because, like, when you think of columns, you think of, like, the value names, right, or the variable names. You don't really think of, like, oh, is this column 7? Like, I don't know. You know what I mean? Like, it's simple width. Like, you know what I mean? Like, so there are very few applications for this specific thing, but be aware that that is a thing. On the other hand, for dot lock or dot loc, right? Whatever, the thing that actually allowed us to do conditions. For this, we actually can give it conditions for filtering our rows and and then names for selecting columns all in one, you know, kind of query. Okay? So, and again, this, I'm able to kind of break this up over multiple lines, so it's a little more readable. And here, I don't need the slash, right? I don't need the, like, continue line thing, because I actually already have, like, an open bracket here. And so Python actually just knows, like, okay, go ahead. Like, you can go ahead and continue, you know, onto the next line, and it's fine. I'll know what you're doing because we've got a bracket open here. Right, so here's how we can actually do queries that are kind of more like, you know, what we're thinking here, right? Like that we can filter by rows and then pull out specific columns all at once, all in one method without having to break things up. Okay? And then, yeah, this is just an example of if I try to use iloc or iloc and I try to use indices for my rows, but then give it like a name for a thing, it's going to give me an error. It's going to say, I don't like doing this. So, and here, so kind of again back to Gaston's sort of question. So, this again points to this line here. It points to like all the instances where it's like, well, then in this thing, this calls this, right? So we have this self.getItemTuple of key. But then this actually checks, you know, self.hasValidTuple, right? So there's like all this stuff that happened that made it so that this error came out. I mean, sure, that's not really helpful though. Like, that doesn't really help me know what went wrong. But here, the error, or the value error, it just says location-based indexing can only have integer, integer slice, start point is included, end point is excluded, list like of integers, Boolean array types. Like, you can only have this kind of thing, so it's like you're giving me something that's like not a type that I can use for indexing, is what it's saying. Right. On the flip side, if I try and call a column using an index number in luck, this is not going to work either, right? It's expecting the columns to actually be called by name in this method. So if I try and like mix and match, I guess, within a particular method, it's not going to like that, right? So here it says, cannot do label indexing on this thing with these indexers, right? So you've given me an indexer that I can't really use, right? So you can do luck, which will let you use conditions and names, or you can use iloc, which will let you use just index numbers, period. But you have to kind of be consistent with your rules within each method, because it's neither one is going to let you mix and match. Like, both of them are expecting a particular thing for rows and columns, and that's what we want to see. Okay? All right. So, let's see. Here is kind of where we... Let's see. That is randomly missing data. Yeah, so we actually kind of are to the point now where I'm still writing this notebook, so let's see. I don't know if I have any. I think that's where I stopped, is because I don't actually have data that's missing anything. But anyway, there's also this drop NA. Method, which will actually drop any values that are missing, right? So here the default axis is 0, so this basically means that we're going to go through and we're going to drop any rows where there's anything missing in that row, right? So kind of like, if you guys recall, the complete.cases function from R, right? That would return true only if like every value in that row was not missing, right? So this is kind of, this is basically a method that does what we did at the end when we were looking at R, where this will only keep the rows that are totally complete, right? And like anything else, too, just about in pandas, you can see that this has an in-place argument that is actually set to false. So this on its own won't actually alter your... I already messaged that like two recruiters today. I got like some other guy that's messaging me. Anyway. So yeah, if we want this to actually like really, you know, change this data frame, then we would set in place the true. Right? So we can do drop NA. We can do fill NA. And so then this has like a fill value, right? So it actually would probably make more sense rather than calling this on like a whole data frame, right? To do something like you know, call like a specific
column.
A specific column. And then fill NA, and then it's gonna ask like what value do you want this filled with, right? So if it's missing, I'm gonna just say like, well, let's just assume that it's like the average, right? So then in that case we would do service.df. Sepal length, and this actually has a method for taking the mean of this thing, right? So we're saying, like, just take the average, and then all the things that are NA, like, fill them with that average value that we're calculating. And you can see, again, kind of what our code is getting quite... long, so I would do something like this. Oh, I hate the like predict or whatever in this thing. Right, so I would fill this in more like this. So it's like, okay, so I take iris df, I use the dot loc thing to locate the thing I want, and then I use the dot fill na to fill in the NAs with the mean value or something like that, right?
These two?
Sorry?
These two only?
No, there are a lot. There are lots of ways you can handle it.
So the backslash is doing like a type, you just pass the information on.
Yep, yeah. Or basically to the Python interpreter, it looks as if I have written all of this on one line, right? So like what I had before where this just was like stretched across the whole line, this makes it so that to Python, this still looks like that, right? But now to a human, it doesn't look like that. It actually is kind of broken up so that we can, you know, go, oh, okay, like, so here are all the, right? So if we have like a line for each method here, then you can kind of think of this almost like there's like a new line for each like step of the process that I'm doing here, right? So that a person can read this and go, okay, so we started with IrisDF and then we did this step. And then we did, after we did this step, we did this step, right? And then if I did more, right?
Then backslash, yeah.
You know, and, oh my god, I hate the predictive thing. Normally people talk about this as being such a great feature of an IDE, but like, oh my god, it tries to predict like everything.
Do you have to do something for it to give you that pop-up?
I don't know, I'm sure there's something I can do to disable, but... It's never irritating enough that it's like worth looking through like all the options to do it. Right, so we can do that, and then I can go continue on to the next line. Oh. You know, and then like some other method, right? So I can actually have like kind of a complex sequence of like things that are happening and methods that I'm calling on my object, but then, you know, this actually becomes still pretty. This is still pretty clear, to anybody who reads my code that one, like, all of this stuff here is like, you know, one process that's happening, right? Because all this is indented, right? And then each step has its own line. And actually, each thing, so like whatever this thing does, this, you know, alters it, albeit temporarily, and then sends it to this thing, right? And then this alters it and sends the output of that to this thing and so on. And so then if I wanted at the end to then, you know, permanently change my thing, then this method at the end should have an in place argument. So I'll just do in place equals true here. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Give me a second to write it.
Sure. And actually, as well, I should kind of denote or point out, like, if I'm only going to pass like one single argument, say, to one of these things, I don't bother like making new lines for these things. However, if there are like, say, four arguments that I need to specify for other method here, then I would actually do this. So now I'd be like, oops, arg1 equals, you know, something. Arg2 equals something, right? And so on, so that now everyone can see, like, so all the things that are new lines that are at this level of indentation, these are like steps, right? These are like separate steps of like, I did this, and I did this, and I did this, and I did this thing. In this thing, there are these other things that I did in here, and so here's, you know, you can see these things very easily as well, right? So I define this argument, you know, and so on. Okay? Because that's just sort of like a syntax, you know, thing. But this is the important part. Okay. All right. So let's see here. What else did we want to talk about? So another concept that's important to talk about. So I'm going to use this kind of vernacular, or this kind of, I don't know, name for it from R, just because I think it's actually very informative. But there's this notion of like two table verbs, right? The things that we do, we actually can kind of think of them as like verbs, right? Like actions that we perform on tables. So, we can actually perform joins like you guys might expect or even be familiar with, like with SQL,
mm-hmm.
Right? But, so let's see, I don't have two tables here. Yeah, that's why sometimes this is like hard or like long to write, is because it's like hard to come up with like good data sets that you can use as like examples for this kind of thing. But, so there's the merge function. Oh, not np, sorry. So pd.merge. So this will actually take two tables, And then there's this by. So there's a by argument that tells you, like, the variables that you're going to join by. And then there's also this how argument, which is going to be, like, what type of join, right? So this is a left join, right join, inner join, full join, whatever.
When do you, when you're trying to type, like, the functions, and there is a pop-up, I always see there is a pop-up. What do you get to do that? What do you do to get it?
Tab.
Just a tab.
Mm-hmm. So here, let's be looking here, like left. Okay. So it's important to know that, so like we call these things commonly in like SQL and actually in R as well, we call them joins. There actually is a pd.join function. Maybe I'm just thinking of the wrong specific name. Not to my webs. Something about our TAE Wi-Fi is not really working very well. Like I've had a really hard time getting on the internet on the TAE things lately. So anyway, I'm pretty sure that there is a function that's like join or something that's like, you know, called join or something similar to that. I almost never use it, and you guys will probably find that you almost never use it as well. There we go. Because this actually does not join the way that you expect it to.
So we'll be using merge.
Oh my god.
No way.
I must just be doing really suspicious stuff here, like looking at data science or something.
I didn't know they were called by high runs.
Oh, really?
Just yeah. One there, pop up, three of them. Again. <That's it.
laughs> Oh, my God.
And the
that's not good. Yeah, how many of these are they gonna have me do? You're right.
Okay,
it took you that long to be convinced that I'm not a data center, that I'm not a robot. Okay, so maybe this is actually like a method. Yeah, so we got a data frame and then dot join. And then other is the other data frame. So the difference between this and merge is that the thing that this will actually like join on is the index, not the variable, right? So if you actually say like, oh, well, there's this variable and there's this variable and I want you to join on them, it actually will join looking at the index of those two variables that you've given it, right? So if your indices are not actually like identical across the two tables, then that's it's going to give you some weird result, right? It'll still do it. It'll still do the join, unfortunately. It'll be something other than what you expected. So the one that I use when I'm in Python is merge. I can't remember the last time I used join because I just don't really think of joins in that way. But it exists. Okay. There's also, let's see. This would be more of a single table thing, but there's also pd.melt, which actually just takes a single data frame. So this is how we go from wide to long data. Which our iris data already is long, so yeah, we'd give it the ID vars and we'd give it the value vars. And then just like, so you guys will see that there's actually a function in R that does this as well. We can actually choose value name and variable name as well. So let's see, let me just make up like a dumb example here that we can use. All right, so let's see. So let's make so we've got like a data set of test scores, I guess, right? So now what we'd actually like though is we'd like to have this, so this is in what's called wide format, and we'd like our data to actually be in long format where we actually have a subject field, like an exam field, so like whether it was like midterm one, midterm two, or the final is actually like a categorical variable, and then we want score to actually be like another column there, right? So melt is what would take us from this wide format to the long format that we want. Okay, so we're gonna go pd.melt. We're gonna melt this data frame that we called PD, or that we called DF. Right? Then we're gonna do the ID vars, the variables that we're not gonna do any melting on. So this is subject. Right? And then we have the value variables, so the variables that contain the values that we want. So these are mid one, oops, mid two, and final. Right. We want to then actually give it variable name. Well, I think I just, I can't remember if it's variable name or if it's var name. Var name and die name. Alright, so then the var name, we're going to want this to be test or exam. And then the value name, we want to be. So now you can see that the data frame that this is output is in this long format that we want, right? So now I've got math, biology, Western civilization, like these are all variables. I've got the exam, like midterm one, midterm two, and so on. And then which score corresponds to that exam within that subject, right? So this is what melt. This is what melt did. Does that make sense?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. So let's see. I think that's all the prayers I can think of. If I think of more, then we'll come back and cover them. But I think that's all we need to cover right now. So now we're to matplotlib, which is our library that was primarily used for visualization. And we also have the seaborn, but all I'm really using it to do is to kind of like set the style. And this is even just like the default style of what these look like. So here, I'll show you real quick. So if we do this without the seaborn styling, right, then I can make some data. You plot it. So this is just totally like the vanilla, you know, whatever plot that
plane.
Yeah, that this would create just with matplotlib, without seaborn, right? So we bring in seaborn and set the style.
Mm-hmm.
Then seaborn has kind of made this like a more professional quality, like, you know, publication quality. I mean, it's still not quite there yet. There's a lot more work I'd have to do, but yeah. So basically what we do here is we use this plt.figure to first create a figure object. And then basically everything that we add on here, it actually just knows like that we're adding features to our plots. And it basically builds them in layers. So if we want just some kind of line plot, then we actually can just use this plot function, right? So we've got data here, we've got x and y that I've just made randomly here. So if I want some line plot, then I just give it plot x and y, right? So x is what's going to be on the x-axis, y is going to be on the y-axis, right? Now if I want to do stuff like a little bit nicer here, that I can still kind of add stuff on here. So I can go X label, right? And then I give this some value. So we'll just call it X because it's not really anything. And same thing with the Y. So we can do a Y label, right? We'll just go ahead and call this Y. If I want the plot to have a title, there it is. Right, there you go. Oh no. Right, whatever I want it to be. Right, and then I add all this stuff in. And now it's added in the label X, the label Y, it's added in the title,
mm-hmm.
all that kind of stuff, right? So again, there are tons and tons of features in this package as well. There are entire courses you guys could buy or take online that would spend, you know, 50 hours just covering, like, the features of matplotlib. So it's a very, very big, very fully featured package. It's really great. But all this is really meant to do is just kind of give you guys like a basic introduction to what you do. Also, if we're in Jupyter Notebook, you guys can see here I have this line here, this percent, and then matplotlib inline. So Jupyter Notebook actually has some things that are specific to Jupyter Notebook. So this percent stuff, anything that's like percent something, they call it magic. It's like actually what they call it. So this is some magic that makes it so that your plots appear inline in matplotlib. Okay. If you're in some other, you know, more commonly used IDE for like professional development, right? Because I just use this to kind of like show you guys stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're in like PyCharm or Visual Studio or something like that, it's actually not going to just automatically show the plots when you're ready to when you're done making them. So when you're done, when you're at the end here, this won't do anything in in Jupyter Notebook, but you need to include this plt.show. So you need to use the show function to say, like, now show me the plot. Okay?
Right.
So, yeah, these are just things to remember, to bear in mind. Again, Stack Overflow is definitely your friend here with this package. So if there's, like, a specific thing that you know you want to do, like, you know, oh, I need to make a box plot, and I think it looks cleaner without showing the outliers, like all the points that were, like, would go beyond the whiskers. Like, I actually don't want to show those. I just want to show, like, the box and the whiskers. You know, like, so you, there's some way to do that, right? But, like, it's not a thing that I do commonly enough that I need to, like, memorize how to do that, right? Because I can always just look up on Stack Overflow how to do that specific thing when I'm in that, like, weird situation, right? So it's better to just kind of know generally how it works, and then you can look up how to do specific things when you're in whatever situation, right? So here, I'm going to generate some other data, right? So now we've got you, we have Y, and we have you. So I can actually also plot, like, different things as well. So I can do this scatter, which is going to give us a scatter plot, right? But I can actually plot. So here I'm plotting X versus Y, and I'm telling it, give this label Y, and then this is X versus U, and I'm giving this the label U, and then if I want that to actually show up as something, I'm going to give it this legend argument so that this legend actually shows up as well. Right? So I use scatter quite a lot because, again, we're trying to, like, just look at data points. You know, so for example, this looks like data that we would normally see, right? It's kind of random. There's some you know, noise in it, but there's this overall linear trend, right, for sure, right? So stuff like that, right? So I use scatter quite a lot just to kind of look at data points, because it's also not necessarily the case that, like, things are connected in this in some cases. Like, for example, if I wanted to track, like, stock prices, then, like, yes, there actually is this clear, like, connection over time, right, of, like, you know, one stock price to the next, and so I would use plot to actually plot, like, a line, right, so I can actually see, like, a graph of the stock prices that looks like this, right? I wouldn't do a scatter plot for that situation. On the other hand, if I'm trying to model, like, house prices, you know, and I've got, say, here a plot that's, like, square footage of the house, right, and then this is, like, the house price. Each data point in that case is actually, like, a different house, so there's no, like, connection, right? Like, in a stock chart, right, like, this is the same stock, like, always, right? So I do want to see, like, what path has this thing taken over time. Here, these things aren't connected to each other. These are all different houses, and I just want to see, like, is there a trend in terms of, like, how the price looks as a function of, say, the square footage, right, or square meters or whatever you guys do over here, right? So I would use a scatter plot in, like, a situation like that, right? And then another thing that we see sometimes is, like, a histogram or a density. So we just, in that case, would give it one variable, right? Because the height is actually determined by, like, how frequently does a particular value occur, right? So we just give it the one thing, and then it shows us, like, all right, here's this histogram or density that gives us the distribution of that thing, or how things are distributed in that vector or in that array that we're being given. Right, and here not only am I actually giving a label, right, for the x-axis, and here you guys can also see that the font here is bigger, right, than it was here. Right, so I actually can give it this argument font size that actually makes the font bigger so that it's more readable, right? But also the other thing that I'm doing is, I'll just tell you this one other thing really quick. So I'm using this xlim method as well, which actually sets the limits of the x-axis. So you can see that x now only goes from -1 to 1, because I've set the limits from 1 to 1. We take this out, what's that, Giannis?
Finish it.
So if we take this out, then this will actually just kind of find an axis that maybe makes more, axis limits that maybe make more sense given what we're looking at, you know. But if there's like a specific part that I want to zoom in on or whatever, you know, I want to see like what's happening in a particular spot, right? Like maybe actually, like, oh, -2 to -1 looks kind of interesting, right? Like, I mean, it's not, but you know, like whatever. It doesn't look interesting in this case, but say it does, right? Right. So yeah, man, that is so off.
So interesting.
Millions. We'll make millions off this, right? Right, or say maybe like, you know, -2 to 2 or something like that, right? Like we can kind of just zoom into different parts of the plot here by setting the limits, right? You can do the exact same thing for y as well. Right, so these are definitely the most common, most useful, like, you know, features that you're gonna use in this package. Anything else is a little more niche and a little more crazy, and I'll let you, you know, Google it and look on Stack Overflow and then ask me if you still can't figure out what to do there. Okay?
One question. In the first plot, I did this, I write this label, and Y label, it shows the Y horizontal. Can we do it vertical? You see? It's not...
In this one?
Yeah. If you go left... Yeah.
Oh, there?
It's horizontal. Can we do it vertical to read?
I'm certain you can. There's just like probably some thing you'd have to tweak, but I, again, don't deal with it
transpose
enough. That...
Transpose.
The other thing, too, to think about is what it's going to do if you do something like that. Because, like, in you know, real situations, right, you're not just going to put Y, you're going to put something like, you know, house price, like, you know, house prices in Boston or whatever, right? So if you, you know, let it go up the side like that, like, then it's not going to really be taking up a whole lot of real estate for your graph. If you insist, like, I actually want you to spell this out horizontally, it will do that. But then it's going to say, okay, like, house prices in Boston, and then your chart's going to start here. And it's going to look weird because you're going to have this whole, like,
yeah,
title for this axis that takes up a shitload of space, right? So, yeah, just think about stuff like that when you're kind of formatting these things.
You want to extend the name or something.
Yeah. So, yeah, so that's kind of, I think that's mostly what you're going to need to know to get started, and then the rest of it you guys will definitely be able to practice as you're dealing with real data sets that I'm going to give you guys, well, real practice data sets that I'm going to give you guys to work with.
The second graph,
mm-hmm,
earlier on you said that there is noise. What gives you that hint that there's noise?
Oh, so just that there just obviously is some random noise, right? Like I see that there's like overall a linear trend, right? But there's not this like, it's not this perfect line, right? So what I'm looking at clearly either is just not deterministic, right? Or there are other variables that are not being measured here that are generating this like, you know, wiggling that I'm seeing about the overall linear trend, right? And actually, to give you kind of a little more of a hint here, if you look at how this data was generated, right? So we're saying 14 minus 4.1 times x. If I just stopped there, I would just get a perfect line that like fits that equation, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I would have a deterministic thing that I'm looking at. But I'm saying, yeah, so there's that general trend, but then plus some random noise.
Random noise, oh,
right?
Okay.
And so then that's how we get these dots just kind of, you know,
okay,
scattered about this overall linear trend,
mm-hmm,
right? So, yeah. There's not any kind of, like, deep, you know, hidden meaning about that. Sometimes when you hear... So noise is, like, an interesting word that we use a lot in data science. Sometimes when people talk about, like, noise, right, they could be talking about this. Like, oh, there's just some random noise, right, about this linear trend, right? There is clearly some line you could, like, draw through this, but then these points are kind of randomly scattered about that line. So there's clearly some random noise in there, right? That's one way that we might talk about noise, or that we might use the term noise.
And also can be, like you just did, purposely, you just want random...
Well, I'm trying to make graphs that look like real data, so I'm doing that to simulate the data. Normally, you will not have to do that. It will do that all on its own, okay? So the other way that we can think about noise or talk about noise is, this gets a little bit into a theory called signal theory or signal processing theory, or even information theory a little bit. So, say there's, you know, stuff that we, something we're wanting to predict, right? So, basically, we'll have variables in the data, right, that we're trying to use. We're trying to use information in that to predict this target thing, right, that we're interested in. Now, we say that we are looking for a signal, or that we're hoping that there's a signal in the data that we're trying to detect for this thing, right? So, like, house prices, say, because that's what I said this graph might represent, right? So, what I'm hoping is that number of bedrooms, number of bathrooms, the living space, you know, in square meters or square feet or whatever, the size of the lot that it's on, whether or not it has a pool, I'm hoping that all these things contain a signal that would inform my model, or that would tell my model what the house prices are, right? There might also be contained in the data, you know, one way or another, just other information that actually doesn't in any way help you predict house prices, right? And this stuff is called noise. So you might also hear people say, like, we have really noisy data, right? Because we're talking about that in any data set, there's the signal and there's the noise, right? And hopefully the ratio of signal to noise is high, right? Hopefully we have lots of signal compared to how much noise is in the data. But if that's not so much the case, if the there's like some signal, but also like quite a lot of noise, we'd say that that's a noisy data set, right? This is noisy data. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It's kind of the other
I've heard
thing
about
that someone might mean if they say something
learning.
Like noise.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Cool. All right, let's go to lunch.
Good luck with the meeting.
Thank you.
Oh, is
for
it now?
Osmos.
It's in like an hour, so I've got enough time to go eat. And I've got to...
Should we finish for today then?
Yeah.
Okay.